Spirit, we invite your presence into this room right now. We invite your holiness, your happiness, your joy, your intensity, every bit of who you are. Walk into this room right now. We ask you for that tenderness that comes at the end of conferences where you just cry like a little baby and you don't even know why. I already feel it. I don't know that I can sing tonight. We'll see what happens. Holy Spirit, we just love your presence. We thank you for everything that you've done over the past couple days. We ask you to do even more tonight. Even more tonight. Sing this with me. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him. Sing. Let's test it. Sing it again, straight to his heart. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. singing amen. Wow. Singing amen. I hear those harmonies. Singing amen. So does the Father. He's singing. Singing amen, singing amen, singing
amen.
The sweetest sound I know, singing
amen.
Again, singing amen. Singing amen. So let our voices rise and all creation cries, singing out an endless Alleluia.
From this moment,
come on, join. Join with heaven's song. We're singing out in endless Alleluia. Again, from this moment on, we join with heaven's song. We're singing out in endless. Go up with me, Alleluia. I can feel your tenderness right now. There's a smile on your face. And there's joy in your eyes, Father. 'Cause we are your children. Just like my boy when he runs to me, there's joy in your heart. There's nothing like it. Yeah. There's nothing like it now. One more time. So let our voices rise. All creation cries, sing. Come on, there's nothing better right here. There's nothing better. There's nothing better, Father. There's nothing better than this right now. There's nothing better. Oh, there's nothing better. There's nothing better than this right. There's nothing better. There's nothing better.
Everything I am, I lay at your feet. Fire. were creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. And from north to south and east to west, we hear Christ be magnified.
Sing this with me. We're the whole earth.
And we're the whole earth echoing His evidence. And His name would burst from sea and sky. From rivers to the mountain tops, we hear Christ be magnified.
Come on, every voice lifted. Oh, Christ be magnified. bow. 'Cause I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me through the fire, I'll rejoice 'cause you're there too. I won't be for my feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. 'Cause if the cross brings transformation, you can. Come on, death. And death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory. Come on, my heart, my heart. Sing that whole thing again. I won't bow to idols. No, I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me through the fire, I'll rejoice 'cause you're there too. And I won't be for my feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. 'Cause if the cross brings transformation, you can hang me there with you. And death is just a doorway.
You are holy.
say this with me. Sometimes.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. It looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. And my story isn't over. My story's just begun, yeah. And fail you want to find me, cause that's what my father does. I said, fail you want to find me, cause that's,
come on, help me with these zoos.
Lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame out.
The story isn't good. And failure's never final. And the father's. Come on, say that.
Say failure's never final. When the father's in the room. Miracles take place now. The sinner will find faith.
'Cause his eye is on the sparrow. And it goes like, no. And I know he watches me. Does anyone on this stage know the rest of that song? Daggum it. Let's just sing that part again then. 'Cause his eye is on the sparrow. Here it is. That's what I was looking for. And I we finally kind of got it a little bit. Just do all the runs right with me, okay? 'Cause his eye is on the sparrow. That's not in the key. Auto-tune got me. And I know he watches. You are good, you're good, and oh, you are good, yeah, you're good, Lord. Oh, you are good, you're good, oh, you are good, you're good, and oh, let the King of my heart. So let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from.
Oh, is my song.
Yeah.
Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Drums.
Oh, is my song.
'Cause you are.
You are good.
so strongly. It's been like hope deferred. The verse hope deferred makes the heart sick. And you've lost hope. It's been a hard year. And you've come here and you've been desperate. Desperate. It's like this is the last straw. God, I'm coming to this conference. I need some type of breakthrough. And this is the last night, and you're coming and you've said, God, tonight I need you to show up. And I feel like tonight he wants to show up. So I just want you to stretch your hands out. He hears you. He hears you. Oh, he hears you. Desperation has been this year for you. Desperation. I just want to, if that's you, lift your hand at the moment of bravery. Just lift your hand if that's you. And I want the room. Let's just become the body of Christ right now. And just simply lay your hand on some of these people that have their hands raised. Let's be the church tonight. And it's the last straw. God, I have to hear from you tonight. Raise your hand. He's going to show up tonight. Come, Holy Spirit. And those who are gathering around them, I just want you to, some of you, it just may be singing in the Spirit over them. He may drop one word for you to speak over them. It may be a Bible verse over them. Let's speak life, hope. Would you come right now and touch these hearts, touch these minds? This is not the end. This is not the end of the story, of the story. And this is not the end. This is not the end. What you've seen is ashes. God says I see it, and it looks like good soil to me. Oh, you said, oh, it looks like ashes. But I see the Father, he's saying, looks like good soil to me. And this is not the end. And this is just the beginning. Oh, and this is not the end. I'm just getting started. And you know me in the rush of the whirlwind. You know me. It's the God. Your tears are just watering your seeds. And this is not the last thing you will feel. This is not the last place you will be. Just lean. Just lean. Every promise he's spoken is yes and amen. Every promise he's spoken, he's yet to fulfill. Every promise he's spoken is yes and amen. Every promise he's spoken, he will fulfill. So don't give up, and don't give in. If you don't quit,
thank you. invite Wayne to come on up. It's so good to have a prophet in the house. And I just asked him, felt during worship that the Lord was speaking something to him. For us as a family of churches, a network as a conference, and I just want him to share.
I believe this is a word for the Radiant Tribe right across the network. And probably the Radiant Tribe is going to be more than you can see today. The lonely days are coming to an end. This is not a time to sing solo, shut up in your silo. It's time to join your voices in one song, with one heart, one mind, out among the people I died for. It's time to walk out into the open fields, the golden harvest fields, and release the sound of heaven flowing through lyrics of hope with rhythms and cadences of grace played on war drums. 2020 pushed you inside to do a spring cleaning, to make ready. 2021 is a year of hospitality and welcome for the prodigals, for the displaced without a home, for the divorced to find their way home. Psalm 133 can be yours if you want it. If unity is precious to you, if you will prefer one another, then I will command a blessing in this place that will awake from sleeping and become a tribe of awakening, living in revival towns across Michigan.
It's just, Lord, we receive that. And Lord, we echo the words of that simple chorus, faithful. Lord, you're always faithful. Lord, you are true. You're good. And Lord, you're here with us. You've been with us. Tonight, Lord, we're asking you to lock in your goodness, your presence. We don't want to miss it. We don't want to reminisce about it. Lord, we want to become carriers of your presence, carriers of your goodness, examples of your faithfulness. Lord, tonight, here we are standing at the threshold of the temple, and we want to see you. Lord, we want to see you as you truly are. Lord, today, shake the foundations. Tonight, meet us in this place. Speak to us, send us back to the cities that bear the names that man has named them, but back with a prophetic imagination about what heaven calls those cities, revival town. Back to those cities that you've marked out to fill and to flood with your presence. Lord, tonight, meet with us. Holy Spirit, come. We're so desperate to hear your voice in a world of 8 billion other voices trying to reach the top of our feeds, trying to garner our attention. Holy Spirit, we have ears to hear only one voice, and it is yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Isn't he good? You can go ahead and take a seat. We're just going to transition this way, if they would, and we don't need a video to roll things in. I've got my Bible and a couple things down there. This is when you know your production level is going out the window. Everything that you plan, the Holy Spirit just messes with. So how many know that's a good place to be at? Thank you. Just, I first of all, I want to say this as a pastor. I'm just so proud of our worship leaders, our production team, our Levites, our musicians that have just served us so faithfully in the presence of the Lord, and honor them. Pastor Caleb and Rachel, you guys just lead so well. We just love you. Hey, can we just do something fun tonight for a second? I mean, not like this hasn't been fun, right? But so something really fun happened this afternoon. My friend Scott back there at the Logos table said, I had something happen that has never happened to me before. He said, I had somebody come up anonymously and purchase 5 sets of Logos 9 gold in cash and want to give them away to some pastors, just free. And so, come on. What's your name, brother? Joe, yeah. Where are you from?
I'm from Mount Hope, Lansing.
Mount Hope, Lansing. There you go, brother. You get one. All right. So that was the wild card. I didn't know who to give that one to. But Edgar Gomez, where are you at, Edgar? Is Edgar here? What? Oh, he left? I guess he doesn't get it. Okay, sorry. That's okay. He'll be all right. Is John Forrester here? John Forrester? John, do you have Logos 9? Do you want it? Okay, here you go, John. I met John and his wife, I think his wife's Maddie, at a conference I spoke at on the east side of the state, young couple, and just loved meeting them and seeing what they're doing. So somebody else paid for it, but I get the joy of giving it to you. So I love that. Garrett Prechtel, where are you at, Garrett? Garrett, come on up. Are you here, Garrett? Garrett, do you have 9? Do you have Logos 9? Come on, Garrett. Look at that. It's like Christmas, brother. Worship pastor, whose name is Pastor Carter. Where are they at? Right there, brother. Where are you from?
I'm from Spring Lake,
Michigan. Spring Lake. Do you have Logos 9?
I don't.
There you go. Bam. There you go. Okay. Last one is Matt McClure. Where's Matt? Matt, come on up here. Matt, do you have Logos 9? You have Logos 1? Okay, well, that's massive upgrade. You're actually going to have to get like a color monitor. And okay, there you go. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Ah, that dot matrix printer. It's going to be tough. But it's all good. I am a terrible self-promoter, and I was told I need to do this. But it's not that difficult to do because I really believe in this. I have a new book that is being released. We had hoped it was going to be here at the conference, but because, like everything else, it's delayed. It's coming in probably next week, but it's going to be nationally released in September with Gateway Publishing. But it's going to be, I think it's available on Kindle right now on Amazon, and it's called School of the Spirit. And this is a book, this is taking everything that I have taught over 25 years on the Holy Spirit and putting it into a book. And I wrote this book as a pastor, because as a pastor, there are lots of great books that you give to new believers, right? About how to begin your journey of following Jesus. The foundations, you know, like baptism, how to pray, how to read your Bible. So, you know, people respond to the altar calls, and we give them these books, and it helps them get their rhythm in following Jesus. But as a pastor, I always struggled with finding a book that you could give to the people in your church about the Holy Spirit, about who he is, what he does, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. There are a lot of great books that talk about that, a lot of great theology books, but not a book that you could, at least I have not found, that you could put into the hands of the average Christian, no matter who they are, charismatic, Pentecostal, Baptist, evangelical, saved for 10 minutes. And I wrote this book for pastors to have a resource to give to the people in their church. And I taught it in my church, and then we turned it into a book. And now the book called School of the Spirit, Living the Holy Spirit Empowered Life, has a study guide with it. And also we're right now producing, but it's gonna come out with the book, a 7-week video curriculum that you'll be able to show in your church. And it will help people encounter and experience the fullness of the Holy Spirit. And so I'm really excited about this book. Robert Morris wrote the foreword, which is a big deal. And I got an endorsement from some great people. This guy named Wayne Drain wrote an endorsement on it. And then one of my heroes, whose name is R.T. Kendall, wrote an endorsement for it. And so I know we're leaving. I think that they have something set up outside in the lobby where you can pre-order it. And I want to encourage you to please get it. You can also get it on Amazon if you like to read the Kindle version. And it's going to then be available. This is a hardcover pre-release copy of it, but it's also coming out in paperback. If you would help me, not only would you get it, but would you help kind of spread the word on that? Because why I'm writing this is I'm believing that as we're talking about an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, that there's a new generation that needs to be introduced to the Holy Spirit. And unfortunately, we have a lot of charismatic churches with the doctrine in their doctrinal statement, but a whole lot of people in our churches that have never experienced the outpouring or the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And so that's why we wrote this, and thanks for all of your help getting that out. I want to spend this last session with you out of Isaiah chapter 6. And so I want to invite you to turn there. The last couple of days have been Holy Spirit orchestrated. I have felt it. I've sensed it. Man makes his plans, but God's wisdom stands. He's orchestrated every session, every workshop, every worship moment. His presence has just been so good and so obvious. And before I knew kind of the direction that this week would take, God gave me a message out of Isaiah 6. And I will tell you that I have spent the last year in Isaiah 6, this encounter that Isaiah has with the Lord. And I've entitled the message I want to finish Arise Shine with this evening as Reawakening to Revival. Reawakening to Revival. Look with me here at Isaiah chapter 6, beginning in verse 1. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. And the train of his robe filled the temple. And above him stood the seraphim. Each had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, and with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And the foundations, and one called to the other and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called. And the house was filled with smoke. And I said, woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hands a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and he said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And then I said, here am I, send me. Lord, today we want to see you like Isaiah saw you. Lord, today we're in desperate need of an encounter with you, not just in a moment, but Lord, in a life transformational way. And I'm praying that every leader, I'm praying that every disciple, I'm praying that every Christian who hears this message will have the eyes of their heart opened to see beyond what is seeable and to hear beyond what is hearable and to see you in your eternal glory and beauty and splendor. In Jesus' name, amen. I wrote this statement down 6 months ago in my journal as I was leading morning prayer. We were praying on this particular morning out of Isaiah chapter 6 and this encounter. And the Lord began to strike my heart about and grip my heart with a fresh revelation of the holiness of God. That God is holy. And I know we say that, but there are moments where you say things that you've always said over and over and over again that your heart actually catches up to your mind and your heart begins to understand that what you're saying is actually true. And I wrote down in my journal that morning that before we can have an Isaiah 60 revival, there must be an Isaiah 6 reawakening. See, Isaiah 60 is that scripture that we built the foundations of Radiant Church upon over 25 years ago. We were given this word by a dear friend when we were launching out. Jane and I were launching out to start a church, 25 years old, really no experience, no people, no money, no idea what we were doing, no building, but we had something that is intangible and irreplaceable, and we had a word from God. And it was Isaiah 60, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Darkness shall cover the earth and gross darkness the people, but the glory of God will be seen upon you." Verse 5, it says, "You shall see and be radiant, and your heart shall exalt." Or one translation says, "It shall swell with joy." That was where, that was the snapshot, that was the vision of what we believe that God had called us to, that God was speaking to the church that the season in the next several years and where we were in the prophetic schedule of heaven was that God was matching and responding to the darkness of the era that was getting darker and darker and darker by a church that was going to come under the influence of a greater glory so that it would be seen upon the church. But oftentimes when we read in Isaiah 60, we don't realize that at least in Isaiah's prophetic calling, there was an Isaiah 6 moment. See, in 2019, God spoke to me about a great reawakening. Now, I'm a student of revival. I've read dozens of books on revival over the last 30 plus years. I've read Edwin J. Orr, I've read Winky Pratney, I've read Arthur Wallace, I've read everything I could get my hands on of revivals. And revivals and great awakenings, there's really language to describe the distinctions of all of them. There's great awakenings, there are great revivals, and there are great renewals. A renewal is what God does in us personally. A revival is what God does to the church. An awakening is what happens when there is a revived church in the culture around it. That's a cultural transformation that takes place. And so when the Lord spoke to me about a great reawakening, I asked the Lord, "What do you mean by a great reawakening?" And here's what the Lord said to me. He says, "In a great awakening, there's a transformation that happens in the culture. But in a great reawakening, there's a transformation that occurs in the church." Where we are reawakened to things that we have fallen asleep to, that we have become apathetic about, that we have become indifferent with. And one of those things is, I believe, the presence and the glory and the holiness of God. Do you know that the Bible says that God is love 2 times? 2 times in the Bible it says, God is love. And right now in our culture we have both in the church and outside of the church, when we have a conversation about God, it always goes back to, well, God is love. But do you know that it says 400 times in the Bible, God is holy? And we've forgotten about the holiness of God. Now, God is love, but his love has to be seen through the lens of his holiness. It's not love the way that man loves. God's love is perfect. God's love is beyond our comprehension. And God wants to restore and reawaken to the church an awe and a wonder at his beauty, at his splendor, at his holiness. This is what happens in Isaiah chapter 6. Most scholars believe that Isaiah chapter 6 is a second prophetic call to Isaiah. You go and read all of the commentaries, and they will say the reason why this moment shows up in Isaiah 6 is because this is a recall of Isaiah back to the prophetic ministry. He was called early on. In the first five chapters are Isaiah walking in that first phase of his prophetic ministry. But then God tears open a hole in the realm between us and him, and he gives Isaiah a revelation that then transforms him and reawakens him both to who God is and to who he is called to be. And I believe in much the same way, the hour that we are in right now, God is preparing the church, reawakening us back to his presence, back to his holiness, back to his beauty, back to his power, back to him being God and us not. See, Isaiah in chapter 6 was living in a time of political transition, of cultural turmoil. Does that sound familiar to you? King Uzziah had just died. In Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, he marks the time by saying, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. This was a significant moment in history. Think about the times in your history that you've lived at that are marked by certain events. Some of you, Dr. Brown mentioned this afternoon about the assassination of JFK. If you're part of that generation, you know the time and place where you were when that took place. If you're like me, 9/11 was a significant mile marker. I remember the time, I remember the place, and for a lot of us, we indicate time by going back and saying, we live in the post 9/11 era. For Isaiah, it was time marked by the death of King Uzziah. King Uzziah had been an incredible king over Israel. It was a time of great prosperity. It was a time of even spiritual renewal that was taking place in Israel. There was a strength of leadership. There was a confidence. Israel was doing incredibly well. The average person in Israel was experiencing peace, prosperity, security, safety, even spiritual vitality. But now the king has died. And around Israel, there is a looming shadow of a rising empire named Assyria that is threatening. They are on their doorstep, ready to attack, ready to assault, ready to destroy everything. And now there's a vacancy, there's a void of leadership. And here's Isaiah, this prophet, who's been called by God, and he says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. And he saw the Lord in the temple. So imagine Isaiah the prophet one day walking up the steps from the Kidron Valley through the eastern gate into the courts of the temple, seeing the activities of the priests, worshiping, offering sacrifices, people praying. It was a sacred space. It was what rabbis believed was where heaven and earth intersected. And Isaiah the prophet was not unfamiliar with the temple. The temple was his stomping grounds. This was where he connected with God. And on this particular occasion, the year that the king has died, he's trying to find his equilibrium. He's trying to find his spiritual balance. God, what does this mean? There's a king coming up behind King Uzziah, who is not a righteous leader. He is not a godly man. And he can begin to feel the turmoil shift in the nation. He can begin to feel the shadow of war on the horizons. The economy is beginning to go into decline, and he's trying to figure out, God, what are you saying to the nation? And as he walks up the steps across the courtyard, and he stands within proximity to the veil that separates the holy place from the most holy place, God pulls back a veil like a sliding glass door between the realm in which he is very familiar and is used to worshiping God with the sights, sounds, smells, and the people that are around him. And God begins to pull back time like a sliding glass door between heaven and our earthly reality. And all of a sudden, the eyes of his heart are thrown wide open, and he sees what he's never seen before in the temple. He sees the Lord. This is not Isaiah out in the field someplace having a trance. He is standing in the temple, the house of God, and he says, I see the Lord. And he is high and lifted up. And the train of his robe is filling the temple. The temple. All he can see is the throne of God. It's the same throne that Moses, when he goes up on Mount Sinai, steps into the darkness and spends 40 days in the presence of God. The throne room of Yahweh comes down on the top of the mountain in fire, in thunder, in lightning, and trumpet blasts. An angelic minister swirling around. It's his throne room that comes down onto the mountain, and Moses steps up onto it, and he begins to describe the throne room of God and the crystal sea that surrounds that throne. It's the same throne that John sees some 2,500 years later after Isaiah, when he's a 90-year-old last remaining apostle of Jesus, and he's been exiled for the testimony of Jesus on the island of Patmos. He's an old man on a rock quarry who thinks his best days are behind him, and Jesus steps through the sliding glass door separating eternity from history, and his eyes are ablaze with fire, and his hair is white like snow, and his voice is like the sound of many waters, and he says, come up here. And John finds himself standing in the throne room of God, and he says, I see the Lamb. I see the one who is seated on the throne. It's the same throne room that Daniel sees when he sees the Ancient of Days takes his throne, and one like the Son of God who ascends up on the clouds and approaches the Ancient of Days, and a kingdom that will never end is given to him. You know, what's interesting about all of the biblical scenes of the throne of God is that it always starts from the bottom up, and it never makes it past the hem of his garment. It always starts with the angelic beings and the glass of sapphire and crystal. And Isaiah gets as far as you can get when he says, and I saw the hem of his garment, the train of his robe, and it filled the temple. It means there was nothing else to see. And he stops. And the reason why he stops is the same reason why the seraphim cover their face with two of their wings. Because all they can say in his presence is holy. 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 2,500 years later, John's in the very same throne room, and guess what the angels are still saying? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was, who is, and who is to come. It's the same thing. They are captivated, as Isaiah is captivated by the one who is seated on the throne, and he begins to see the seraphim, these fiery angelic beings that are swirling in and around the throne of God that has flooded his viewpoint of the temple. He's no longer looking at the beauty of the stonework. He's no longer listening to the songs of the singers or the blasts of the trumpet. He's no longer smelling the aroma of the sacrifices on the altar. He's no longer trying to find his place close enough to watch the priest go through the veil into the Holy of Holies. The veil has been torn, and the Holy of Holies is standing there, and he beholds the Lord who is seated on the throne. And he's holy. And he's transformed in a moment by the holiness of God. Church, we need a reawakening of the holiness of God. Paul writes in Romans 13, verse 11, besides this, you know the time, that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. The night is far gone, the day is at hand, so let us cast off the works of darkness, put on the armor of light, and let us walk properly as in the daytime. Not in orgies and drunkenness or in sexual immorality, sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh and to gratify its desires. Paul is writing to Christians. He's writing to Christians. He's not writing to the world. He's not writing to the secular culture of Rome saying, guys, your sexual immorality and your flesh, and you got to stop all that. No, he's talking to Christians. And what does he say? It's time for you to wake up. It's time for you to awaken and to recognize the day, recognize the moment, recognize that the night is gone and the day is dawning. It's time for us to put on light. What's he saying? It's time for us to reawaken to the holiness of God. Angels in heaven do not cry out, love, love, love. They cry out, holy, holy, holy. Perpetually before his throne. Now, when I mention holy, some of us come from a lot of different backgrounds where holiness means different things. If you came from a holiness background, holiness meant your hair never touched your collar. Holiness meant you didn't watch TV. Holiness, you know, is another way of saying legalism. And I think what's happened in the church is we've overreacted against legalism. And now we've swung the pendulum so far to the other side. It's cheap, weak grace, where anything goes because God is my homeboy. And because Jesus, you know, forgives and God is love. And I'm not saying that he isn't. God is love. But he's not defined by the love the way that the world defines love. You want to know how God defines love? Just look at Jesus on the cross. Sacrifice. Laying down his life for us. It's important that we get holiness right. When I say holy, here's what I mean. The biblical definition of the holiness of God is God's otherness. It's his distinctiveness. It's his terrifying otherness. His ethically pure, absolutely upright, and utterly true. This is what I mean by the holiness of God. I'm not talking about the legalism that man imposes. Even legalistic standards that the church historically has put into place started off as a true desire to serve God in beauty and to serve God in true holiness. And it's most often the response to an Isaiah 6 encounter. John Wesley, who's one of my heroes in the faith, didn't start off with a list of all of these things that are do's and don'ts. They formed over time because Wesley had encountered the Lord like Isaiah had encountered the Lord. And it so transformed him as an Anglican minister who had once and for all figured out that he could not be saved by his efforts or by being a missionary or being a scholar. He had experienced the love of God, the holiness of God, and it had transformed him. A.W. Tozer says this, God is not now, any holier than he ever was. And he never was holier than now. He did not get his holiness from anyone nor from anywhere. He is himself the holiness. He is the all holy, the holy one. He is holiness itself, beyond the power of thought to grasp or of words to express, beyond the power of all praise. This is what holiness is. And this is what we see in Isaiah's encounter. And I believe with all of my heart that God wants to reawaken the church to his holiness, because it is this type of an encounter that actually prepares us for the revival, the renewal, and the great awakening that we're praying for. If we don't have this, then we're not prepared for that. I've oftentimes asked God, why is it that in third world nations we see miracles break out, signs and wonders, and where is it in America? It seems like every once in a while we'll get, you know, a little sprinkle of it here, a little sprinkle of it there, and God's made it very clear to me. He's like, Leah, if I poured out signs and wonders on the American church the way that the American church is right now, they would merchandise the anointing, they would take the glory for themselves, and they would try and sell it. This is what we do with things. God moves, and we market it. And God says, I will not share my glory with another. What does it mean to have a reawakening for revival? I want to share what I believe are four things out of this encounter that Isaiah had that we need to be reawakened to. And listen, I'm not mad at nobody. I love the church of Jesus. I'm not talking about holiness in the way that we walk around just grumpy and angry and we don't have any fun and we call each other out and it's like, well, I'm just under a burden. No, God wants us to have happy holiness, because God is happy, but God is holy. And I've got notes, but let me just tell you, I think one of the greatest dangers that we have in America is that we've taken God, and instead of asking him for a revelation of how we were created in his image, we've taken God and redecorated him in our own image. And the problem that we have in the American church is that the God that we worship never disagrees with us. It's the last night, so you don't have to come back. It's all right. But if the God you worship never disagrees with you, you might have the wrong God. You see, I want to have my heart awakened to the holiness of God, so that when I walk into his house, I'm not seeing what I've always seen. I want to see beyond what I've seen. I want to see him. There were other people in the temple in Isaiah 6 that did not see what Isaiah saw. I was a 12-year-old kid in a small Assembly of God church in Clarkston, Michigan. Sunday evening service, August 11th, 1984. I did not want to be there. But my grandfather, who went home to be with the Lord this last October, who's my hero, he said, boy, you're going to church. So we went to church, and I couldn't tell you anything about that service other than I probably was drawing on the inside cover of hymnals. There was 15 people in that Sunday night service. I was by four decades the youngest person there. At the end of the service, the pastor did something that you pray he's not going to do. He called everybody up to the front to pray. And so we all got up in the front, and we stood in a big circle holding hands. My Aunt Jeanette on one side and my grandma on the other side, and holding hands, and we're praying about things. It was one of those prayer meetings where we're praying for Aunt Mildred's bunion, and it was something like that. It was just, and I remember being a 12-year-old kid staring at the ceiling tiles, just trying to find patterns to pass the time. And in a moment, God pulled the veil. And I was in another place and in another time. And God showed me pictures and scenes out of my life that had been painful even to a 12-year-old kid. And he began, I don't have any words to describe what took place, but in a moment I knew that I had never been alone. I knew that it was not the end of the story, and God made sense of my story. And I heard him say, Lee, I've called you to be a voice to your generation. Rise up and prepare to serve me. A 12-year-old kid in the front of a Good Shepherd Assembly of God, a building that's not even there today. But every time I drive by it, I always point it out and say, that's where God called me. You see, I was standing there, and when I came back into the room, my grandparents wondered what was happening to me. I was on my knees. I was in tears. My life was never the same. I was called. And I got up from that place, and I spent my teen years pursuing God. I was in the room, but I saw something that nobody else saw in the room. Like Isaiah was in the temple, and he saw something that nobody else saw in the temple. I wonder what would happen if we, as people who are in the body of Christ, living in the same time, in the same era, in the same culture, with the same difficulties and the same challenges, were people that had eyes to see and were able to see something that God was doing in the midst of the rest of the culture around us, who's captivated by this, who's captivated by that, who's listening to this voice, who's going over here, who's getting caught up in this trapping. And instead of staring at our screens, we had the eyes of our heart open to be able to stare at the throne. What if we were more captivated by the one who's on the throne than the one who's on the screen? What if we became followers of the Lamb who's on the throne instead of the followers of the person on Instagram that doesn't even care about us? What if we started pressing into the one who's on the throne and we never made our way above the train of his robe because it so captivated us? Reawakening of the American church to what? Number one, to God's holiness. Lord, would you reawaken us to your holiness? We confess, Lord, we are strangers to your holiness. But Lord, we want to draw near. We want to see you as you truly are. Lord, reawaken us, number two, to repentance, because this is what a reawakening of holiness always leads to. Isaiah's response to this theophany was, he says, woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I come from a people of unclean lips. Isaiah's response to the holiness of God was a reawakening to repentance. We need a reawakening to the posture of repentance. William Booth, who was the founder of the Salvation Army, many of you know this quote, but it's so prophetic about the era that we live in. This is over 100 years ago. He said this: the chief danger that confronts the coming century will be religion without the Holy Ghost, Christianity without Christ, forgiveness without repentance, salvation without regeneration, politics without God, and heaven without hell. Forgiveness without repentance. We all want forgiveness. But the other side of the coin of forgiveness is true repentance, where we are so caught and struck by the beauty and the power and the glory and the splendor of the God that we serve, that our heart is so sensitive to him that when things come up in our heart and in our life, when sin that has so easily beset us begins to rise in our lives again, that there's a quick response to repentance. That in our churches, we're calling people to repentance. Yeah, but Pastor Lee, people don't like to hear about repentance. What we want is we want forgiveness. Give me forgiveness. God is so gracious to forgive us. But there's something about the brokenness and the contriteness of our heart that actually throws open the door and gives us the ability to receive the forgiveness the way that God genuinely wants to release it in our lives. I think some of the reasons why we see so many people falling away right now you know, a departure from the faith. I think we're all trying to figure out who's here, who left, who stayed, who's engaged, and who strayed. One of the reasons why we're seeing such a falling away is because there's a lot of people who came into the kingdom and were born again with birth defects because of an incomplete gospel. We've told them, give your life to Jesus, and he's got a wonderful plan for your life, and we didn't prepare them for difficulty. We treated the gospel like Jesus wants to love you, he wants to forgive you, and you're perfect just the way you are. And we forgot about the part where Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, let him take up his cross, deny himself, and follow me. We say, well, you know, he forgave the woman that was caught in adultery. He said, your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. Where are your accusers? But we forget the part where he says, go your way and sin no more. We've not preached repentance. We've not called people to repentance. And listen, no one can come to the Father unless the Spirit draws them. But let me tell you, one of the things that the Holy Spirit does is he convicts. Convicts of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. And we need to be reawakened to the holiness of God, but we also need to be reawakened to the art and the posture of repentance before the Lord, because without that, we can't be reawakened at all to number three, which is the conversation of heaven. Church, we need to be reawakened to the conversation of heaven. What do I mean by that? Well, when you look at Isaiah's story, immediately the angel, the seraphim, comes and brings a coal and touches it to his lips. And he says, now you're cleansed. Now you're purified. It was a coal off of the altar of the Lord. It was cleansing. It was purifying. And immediately, what does Isaiah begin to hear? He begins to hear the Lord begin to speak in the midst of his council, his angelic council, his leaders of heaven, his divine council. And he says, who shall we send? Who will go for us? And Isaiah's over here going, ooh, pick me. But the only reason he could respond by saying, God, send me, was because he was able to hear the conversation of heaven. There was a young man named Samuel in 1 Samuel chapter 3. It talks about his early beginnings. It says, now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli. And the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no frequent vision. And at that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his own place. There was a time in Israel's history where even the prophet, even the priest, Eli, began to experience his eyesight physically beginning to grow dim, but his spiritual sight beginning to grow dim to where there was no widespread revelation in the land whatsoever. God had raised up prophets, but the prophets were not able to see what God was doing, and they were not able to hear what God was saying. And so there was a famine in the land for the word of God. And in the middle of that, God raised up this young man named Samuel. And what does Samuel hear as he's in the tabernacle, the house of God? He's lying there, and he begins to hear the conversation of heaven. Samuel. Samuel. Who is that? Is that you, Eli? What is it? What do you want? That wasn't me. Go back to bed. Samuel. Samuel. A young man was being raised up who knew how to hear the conversation of heaven. When we look back on church history, there were moments like in the Welsh revival where God grabbed a hold of a young man who sought him with all of his heart, who God gave him the gift and the ability to hear the conversation of heaven that became the guide for the Welsh revival. We've experienced, I believe, a period of time in the body of Christ where there's been very little widespread revelation. There's been a lot of great sermons. There's been a lot of great worship songs. The artistry is flowing. But just like in Isaiah's day where the priests were walking in the courts, they were operating in two dimensions. And I believe that God is raising up a generation and he's inviting the church to be reawakened to his holiness, to be reawakened to repentance, so that we can be reawakened to the conversation of heaven. Psalm 103 says, he, the Lord, made known his ways to Moses, but acts to the people of Israel. Much of the church is content to see the acts and the works of God, but we want to become like Moses that says to the Lord, I want to know your ways. God, I want to know what you're up to. What did Jesus say to the disciples? I no longer call you servants, but I call you friends. Why? Because servants don't know why and what their master is doing. They just know what they're supposed to do. They know the what. But when God invites you into friendship and into partnership with him, he's inviting you behind the closed doors of the office in the war room of heaven. He says, let me not only share with you what I'm going to do, let me share with you why I'm going to do it. I want you to know my heart. I want you to know my timing. I want you to know my tone. And Isaiah was there for that. He heard and he felt and he was part of the conversation of heaven. Church, we got to get back to the place where our ear is tuned in to the voice of the Lord. That before we get into the pulpit, we're not just downloading the latest sermon off of somebody's website and saying those are three good points and a funny illustration and a video clip. We need to stand up in our pulpits and we need to be able to say, I've been in the throne room with God. I've overheard what the Father is saying and I've brought the word of the Lord to this church. E.M. Bounds in his book, Power Through Prayer, says, what the church needs today is not more machinery or better, not new organizations or more and novel methods, but men whom the Holy Ghost can use. Men of prayer, men mighty in prayer. The Holy Ghost does not flow through methods, but through men. He does not come on machinery, but on men. He does not anoint plans, but men. Men of prayer. See, that's what prayer is. Prayer is us getting in the throne room of God and overhearing. I think God loves to do that. I think in Isaiah's story, I think the Lord's having this conversation within the Trinity and within his divine counsel. And he's not caught off guard that Isaiah's listening in. He's actually kind of doing it. He's doing it on purpose. You know the way that parents do it with their kids. Oh, who's going to take out the trash? Oh, the trash really needs to, guys, you know your wife will do that. They'll go, oh, the trash really needs to go out. And you know what they're looking for? Is you to go, I got that. Oh, who's going to walk the dog? And all of a sudden your kids are like, I got homework to do. Or parents, sometimes if you know, you might slip up and you want your kids to kind of hear something so they think they're on the inside, that they've got the scoop. But you're actually leaking it on purpose. It's like, now don't tell your brother. Don't tell your brothers and your sister because it's a secret. We're going to Disney. I didn't really want you to hear that, but you're leaking it. And it's like, oh yeah, your secret's safe with me. I think God's like, whom shall we send? Oh, I don't know. Whom shall go for us? We need a prophet, guys. I mean, what are we gonna do? Gabriel? Michael, I mean, Jesus, oh, guys, anybody got any ideas? And it's as if the Father's saying, do you get the clue? I want you to go for us. And Isaiah steps up and says, here am I, God. It's a reawakening of his prophetic call. He now, in the presence of God, has remembered why he was called in the first place. He remembers that burning in his heart to declare the word of the Lord, like Jeremiah said, it's fire shut up in my bones, and woe is me if I do not speak it, if I do not declare it. Isaiah's having a reawakening in his heart of who God is, how pure and beautiful and holy he is. Here am I. And in one final moment, Isaiah is reawakened to his mission. Church, we need a reawakening to our mission. We're called to make disciples. We're called to go into all the world. Barna's latest research, when asked evangelical Christians, what is the Great Commission? Only 19% even knew what it was. The Great Commission has become the Great Omission, where we're focused on all kinds of other things. And listen, when the church, when a generation rises up like Gen Z and the millennial generation, that now combined are the single largest generation in American history combined. And a generation like that rises up in the church and has sat in our Sunday school classes and in our youth groups and in our services, and when asked, they don't know what the single commission that Jesus gave the church is, but they can tell you all about social justice. They can tell you all about the causes that are going on and all the people they follow on Instagram. They're following them because those people have said yes to a cause, and the church has forgotten the primary purpose that Jesus left us on the planet. Jesus did not leave us on earth when he left because he didn't have room for us in heaven. Jesus left us on earth to occupy until he came to make the gospel preached to all ethnic groups, all nations on the face of the earth before the end comes. He told us in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, remain in Jerusalem until the promise of the Father comes, because when it comes upon you, you shall receive power from on high, so you can have really good feelings and fun services. No, he says, you shall receive power and on high, and then you will be my witnesses, beginning where? In Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then don't leave America. He called us to go. He called us to be bold. He called us to be courageous. He called us to be so captivated by who Jesus is that the pressure from this world pales in comparison to the glory that is being revealed in us. And he was reawakened, he was recommissioned. And Isaiah prophesied Isaiah chapter 60 because he had encountered the Lord in Isaiah 6. He says, I have seen the King, the Sovereign. I believe Jesus wants to reawaken us. I'm not just talking about like right now. I'm not just talking about you individually. I'm talking about our churches. I'm talking about the body of Christ. I'm talking about the hour that we are in, that right now, if we will receive the invitation, who will go for us? And we say, Lord, here am I, because I've seen you. Because my heart refuses to be fascinated and refuses to become distracted by all the temporal things of this world. And I'm coming after you because I've got to see you. And my heart is so rent that anything that is clinging or holding to me, I'm casting off every weight and every sin so that I can behold you and draw near to you in the secret place and live a life where I'm listening and engaging in a conversation with the courts of heaven, and my life becomes fueled and motivated to walk out the purposes that you have for me and the church. If we'll do that, listen, there will not just be a reawakening in the church. There will become an awakening in our nation, in the next generation. That's what I'm praying for. I want you to just stand with me tonight, if you would. Tonight, before we leave this place, I believe that God wants to give us a recommissioning, a fresh, new commissioning, a reawakening to our call. I'm not saying re-saved. I'm not even talking about you're in negligible sin. I'm not talking about those things that may be true, but it doesn't necessarily need to be. Just talking about re-upping. Not out of obligation, but out of fascination. Just saying, here am I, God. Send me. Before we leave this place, if in your heart, saying, Lord, in this next season, I've got to see you. I've got to see you beyond the normal that I've seen you. God, I need to encounter you. I want to hear the conversation of heaven. I want to be so purposeful in my pursuit. I want to be reliant on your Holy Spirit. Then before we leave this place, I want you to respond by just stepping out of your seat and making your way to the front. And if you can't get to the front, to just fill the aisles. And we're going to close this conference by consecrating ourselves before God. Even if it's just you shifting one seat because you can't get to the aisle, that one step to that one seat is responding, here am I, Lord. Set the coal to my lips. Set the coal to my heart because I want to burn for you. I want to burn for you, God. Set me on fire, God. I just want you to ask God. It's like, Lord, would you set the coals to my heart? Lord, ignite the fire once again, the first love fire. Fresh and anew, Lord, before we ever leave this place and go back to the cities where you've assigned us and the places that you've assigned us on the wall, Lord, we don't want to go without the fire. We don't want to go without the branding mark of the coals from the altars of heaven, indelibly marking our spirit.
Put me anywhere.
Jesus. Hear my Lord. Send me. Come on, just say that to the Lord. Lord, hear my God. Send me again with fresh fire, with fresh wind. Put me anywhere, God. Just let me be a part of what you're doing, God. Here am I, going back to my city all over again. Not going in my own strength, but I'm going for the glory of God. Lord, I want to be a part of what you're doing. I want to be a part of the story that you're writing over this generation. I want to be a part of what heaven already knows is coming, but earth is earnestly groaning. Lord, I want to be a part of seeing the glory of God arise and dissipate the darkness. I want to be a part of seeing sons and daughters coming from afar. I want to be a part of seeing a generation undone in your presence. God, I want to see you like you really are. I want to see the Lord.
I want to see you, God. Fill me with wonder again. Fill me with passion for your name. Fill me with wonder. Just let me burn. I want to burn for you, God. I want to burn for you, God.
Mark us tonight with the fire of your presence and hearts that are burning for you, God. We want to be burning ones. Lord, I'm praying for every single person that's in this room and then the countless hundreds and thousands that they represent. Lord, set us as a generation on fire once again. Send an awakening, send revival, send renewal, send a reawakening to your church. God, awaken the sleeping giant. Awaken the church back to our first love, God. Relight the flame. a first love flame, Jesus, that once burned bright. Restore to us our first love. Lord, tonight, commission us. Put us anywhere. Just let us see your glory, God. Fill us with courage. Fill us with the love of God that compels us. Lord, fill us with conviction. Deep conviction. Throw open the doors of heaven over our churches, our families. Send us to the nations. Send us to the four corners of this nation. Send revival to America. Send revival to America, God. We're torn. We're bruised. Heal us, God. Heal our land. We're sick. We're wretched. Pitiable. Just one glimpse of you. Just one move. Just movement. Of your hand across our nation can change everything. Lord, from this place, as we all get on planes and in our cars and we go back home, Lord, I pray that we don't fold up what you've said to us, put it in a binder or log it away in a computer and move on, but Lord, let this be our Isaiah 6 moment. And 1 year from now, when we gather back, pray we bring fires from all of the different places. We bring back the oil and we bring back the wine of your Holy Spirit that you've released in our cities, in our churches, in our communities. And we give you all the glory, Jesus. Come on, can we just give him glory tonight? Just praise you, Jesus. Jesus, we give you the glory. So Jane and I want you to know that we love you. And we count it a privilege to call you family. And we're praying the grace, the peace, the strength, and the presence of God goes with you. And we look forward to seeing you. You know what they say this? They say, see you in Jerusalem next year. Well, we can't get there, so I'll see you in Kalamazoo next year. God bless you. We'll see you next year. God bless you.